The new theater of the mind. The Bruce Collins Show.
Hey, welcome back to the Bruce Collins Show. I'm so happy you could join us this week. I think you're going to enjoy the program. We have a very frank discussion coming up later in the hour with veteran radio host Joe Ortiz. The Bruce Collins Show airs every Friday night at midnight right here at WWPR, 1490 AM. You can listen to past archives of The Bruce Collins Show at FringeRadioNetwork.com. That's FringeRadioNetwork.com. There's a tab that if you scroll down, you find The Bruce Collins Show, and it'll take you right to a page that has all of The Bruce Collins Show archives right there at the Fringe Radio Network website. We would appreciate it if you're able to spread the word of our show by word of mouth, social media, or in whatever creative way you can. Also, we have a Facebook page for The Bruce Collins Show. Please like us there. And you can email the show at bruce_collins_show@aol.com. Drop us a line and let us know how we're doing. You know, there's something new we're doing that I know you're going to enjoy. The Bruce Collins Show has a new YouTube channel. Go to YouTube, in the search box, put in The Bruce Collins Show. That should take you to The Bruce Collins channel. Subscribe there and watch our free videos. As I said before, our guest this week is veteran radio host Joe Ortiz, and he joins us in a moment. And joining us this week is Mr. Joe Ortiz, returning to the Bruce Collins Show. Joe Ortiz is a veteran journalist who has worked as a radio television news reporter and talk show host for over 40 years. He has the distinction of being the first Mexican-American to host a talk show on an English-language commercial radio station, beginning his career at KABC Talk Radio in Los Angeles. Throughout his career in media, he has also worked as a social services provider and as an educator at various school districts in California. He is a published author of three books, including The End Times Passover and Why Christians Will Suffer Great Tribulation. Joe, welcome back to the program.
Hey, thank you, Bruce. Thank you for the re-invite. I appreciate that.
Well, it's always great to have you on. Now, this is a new audience for us here in Tampa, Florida. Can you tell us the events surrounding how you became a born-again Christian?
Oh, I love Tampa. I was there once, about 3 or 4 days. Beautiful, gorgeous area. Love it. The question was, repeat that again, I'm sorry.
Tell us about the events surrounding how you became a born-again Christian.
Oh, my goodness. You know, first of all, when I was a little kid, I was, you know, born and raised a Catholic and went to school, to church every Sunday and go to catechism classes after school and so forth, up until like I was about 13 or 14 years old. And then due to a corrupt priest who unfortunately was messing around with some of my buddies that I heard about there, so you know, I guess that stuff's been going on for the longest time. I was very, very upset. My heart was broken because I looked at the priest like, you know, an idol. I looked up to him, a strong father figure, and then I find out that this kind of stuff was going on. So I left the church. I just said, heck with it. Who needs it? So I kind of threw baby Jesus out with the water because I stayed away from any kind of church activities from the time I was 14 up until like about another 20 years later. I happened to be at a church camp in Lake Hume, California, which is some kind of a Baptist church camp. And a buddy of mine invited me to go with him. And I said, okay, fine. I'm sorry, that wasn't 20 years. It was actually 2 or 3 years later when I was about 15, 16 years old. And we went and listened to the sermon, and man, you know, I guess the Holy Spirit really got a hold of me, and I got down on my knees, and I raised my hand, and I surrendered to Christ at around 15, 16 years old. However, when I came back to my hometown, I never really followed up and going to any Assemblies of God or Baptist church or whatever. I just stayed away from it. You know, mm-hmm. I just stayed away from the whole church scene. It wasn't until 20 years later, when I was in Los Angeles, and I happened to pick up a book, believe it or not, called The Late Great Planet Earth, Hal Lindsey's book. So I started reading that, and I said, wow, this, what a trip. And then at the same time, I was also reading a book called God Drives a Flying Saucer, and then I read Eric Von Däniken's book, The Chariots of the Gods. So I kind of put the two together, and I started imagining in my own mind, like, well, maybe God is just one of these guys in a flying saucer, and this is what it was all about. So anyway, about a couple of years later, I'm up there in Pleasanton, California, my sister's home, and she lived there on the ninth hole of this country club. And I'm sitting there having a scotch and on the rocks, and actually I was smoking a joint. Mm-hmm. And I went outside and I started looking out, and I looked up and I saw this bright moon, and I said, you know, if there really is a God, you know, give me a sign. Give me a sign, because, you know, I've been listening through all this, and I don't know what this means with, you know, flying saucers and what Hal Lindsey talks about, a sword protruding out of God's mouth. And it was all this whole confusion. And I said, if you really are a God, you know, show me a sign. Well, right then and there, there's this big, huge peace came over me. And I turned around, and I'm not going to say that I heard God's voice, but I felt something saying to me, like, you know what, you put away the scotch, you put away the marijuana and whatever it is, and I'm going to show you what I'm going to do with you. And I said, hey, man, I've been doing this stuff since I was a kid, and, you know, I try to stop drinking and smoking pot and all that kind of stuff, and it just doesn't work. Well, the next week, one of my kids was picked up by this bus. The Royal Rangers would pick up a bus, would pick up the kids and take them to church. And these were my stepsons. Mm-hmm. And they said, hey, Joe, why don't you go to church with us? I said, ah, man, who needs all that? So a couple of weeks later, it was Mother's Day, and they said, oh, come on, you got to go at least Mother's Day. So I went. So I sat there in the pew, and this preacher started giving this big sermon about husbands love your wives as Christ loved the church and all that. And I'll tell you something, the Holy Spirit got a hold of me and knocked me down, and then I was just turned around, born again, January 5th, 1975. And so I've been following the Lord ever since. I had some many successes and fallen flat on my face a couple of times, but got back up, and the last 15 years especially have been probably the most beautiful, happy moments of my life, and so here I am.
You know, I had a similar experience as you. I was sort of at the end of my rope, but I was raised in church, but I saw a lot of hypocrisy, and I started to drift away, and I basically did what you did. I said, God, I don't know, and I was in a bedroom, you know, by myself, and I said, God, I don't know if you exist, but if you do, I need you to show yourself, show that you
right.
exist.
Show me. And we want to see something that'll be convincing.
And it didn't happen over the course of a minute or two. It actually was towards the end of my praying, and actually I started having faith that he really did exist, and I felt what some people would call the presence of God. And you know, in that experience, I wonder, here's an interesting question: should we encourage those who are lost to pray that kind of a prayer?
You know, I can't remember the exact verse, but it says something to the effect that the Holy Spirit draws a person to God.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? And I really believe that God, the Holy Spirit, are constantly ever present, and that maybe they have been involved in our lives for the longest time. Another scripture said that we were chosen for the very basic foundation of the world, and that maybe not that he is selective you know, like, well, this, you know, Bruce is going to be a Christian and Joe's not. But I just believe that maybe he has opened up the doors for certain people with the opportunity to use their own personality, all the different characteristic traits that he has given each one of us. And so, you know, we really don't know. I just know that looking back at history, the last 35, 40 years, I know that he had a hand in my life, because some of the things that, some of the doors that have been opened for me, especially in media, especially in politics, and especially in certain areas, I would have never, ever even imagined that I would have been in that position. Mm-hmm. I didn't graduate from high school. I said, I'm going to go to college. I'm going to study radio and television and journalism and become a talk show host. You know, I wasn't, I fell into this whole radio thing by accident, or at least I thought it was an accident, but I just happened to be at the right place at the right time. And so in 1971, a friend of mine asked me, he said, would you like to be on radio? And I said, yeah, sure, why not? And I thought he was asking me to be a guest on his program. And no, he was actually, you know, had recommended me to KABC Talk Radio, because they were looking for a Mexican-American to be a talk show host, because the station had been receiving a lot of pressure from the FCC that they should hire minorities. Mm-hmm. That was during the civil rights era, when there was a lot of pressure by African-Americans and Latinos in terms of civil rights and so forth. So I went to the station and met a guy by the name of Bob Walsh, and he said, I hear that you're involved quite a bit in the community and in Latino affairs, and that you're pretty active in civil rights movement and so forth. And I said, yeah. And so I told him some of the stuff that I was doing at that particular point in time. And then he tells me, come here. And he took me outside into this little studio, and he said, I want you to read this. So I said, well, that's funny, you know. So I looked at it, and it just said something like, Lindbergh Nutrition makes the best vitamins in the whole world, and yada, yada, yada. So he said, okay, thank you. So he said, we'll see you later. I said, okay, fine. So I thought I was being, I don't know what the process is to be a guest on somebody's talk show. And I thought that this was part of the criteria to see if they qualified to be a guest or not. So about 3 hours later, Bob Walsh calls me up, and he says, congratulations, Joe. He said, you got the job. And I said, what job? He said, you're going to be the new replacement for our host on Sunday mornings from 9 o'clock till 2 in the afternoon. I said, what? He said, yeah. He said, this guy that was on there, Chico says, but he recommended you. Uh-huh. I said, well, listen, I don't want to take this guy's job. He said, no, he was okay, but he didn't have the in-depth experience in the community, in the political arena and community and civil rights and all that like you do. So we'd like to hire you. Do you want the job or not? I said, of course. So that was back in the early part of 1971, and they threw me the football, and I've been doing that for the last 40 years.
Wow, that's awesome.
Yeah, and it was. I said, what's a gangbanger, you know, Chicano lowrider from Indio, California doing here in Hollywood interviewing presidents and Hollywood celebrities and all that? It was mind-boggling. So when I look back, I have to say, like, I wasn't planning this. So I look at this now, and that God opened up certain doors in certain arenas and whatever, and then everything has been, as long as I'm staying faithful to Him and to His will and to His law and to His mandate, He opens up doors for us to hopefully bring others to Christ.
And I'm sure during your career, because I've seen this too, where God will sometimes shut doors too, and you kind of wonder, why is this happening? But then later on, you get that perspective of being able to look back and saying, oh, that's why. Have you found that?
And that's true, because, you know, if it's easy to get heady in this field, and uh-huh. as I'm sure that you know, because, you know, the more you start hanging around with the celebrities and all that, and people say, oh, you're on radio, yada, 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 you know, that's so cool. It can get kind of heady.
Right.
And for a while there, it started getting heady. Like, you know, here I am, you know, going to parties with Heisman Trophy winners and famous movie stars and the mayors of Los Angeles and all this kind of stuff. And you start, you know, patting yourself on the back, and then he'll knock you flat on your butt and say, hey, this is not why I called you.
Yeah.
And I called you to turn around and follow my precepts. So I had to, you know, reevaluate my time in media and in that arena very, very carefully to make sure that, that I was following him and that he, in that particular arena, to touch people's lives. And it got to the point where the pressure of stardom and the money and all that was just getting too much that I just turned around and said, you know what, I don't want to live this lifestyle, and that's why I left. And so, as I said, for the last 15 years, especially when I left Los Angeles in 2000, I've been the happiest because I've been devoting my life, my work, to helping you know, the downtrodden, the poor folks. I worked at a homeless shelter in Palm Springs for 3 years. I just loved it. I was on duty 24 hours a day and, you know, picking up big boxes filled with cans of food and turkeys and moving refrigerators and beds and stuff that I was not used to.
Yeah.
To the point that I actually injured my back and my and other parts of my body and all that. And so I've been kind of handicapped since 2003. And so what I do throughout the day is I'm in front of the internet. I blog. I communicate with people, share the word, share the knowledge that God has given me, and write articles about certain issues on my blogs and just try to get the message out. And it's been the happiest time in my life.
You know, about 10 years ago, I used to have lunch with a pastor who actually took over when my grandfather retired back in the 70s. So this gentleman is in his 60s, he might even be in his 70s, but we would have lunch every Saturday or every other Saturday about 10 years ago for a couple of years. And he made an interesting point. You talked about people getting heady and becoming
right.
A celebrity. And he said, you know, if the pastors were really doing the work that they should be doing, they should be serving their people. He said,
amen.
He said, I should really be giving you money, you know, to help you, you know, as a pastor,
right.
I should be serving you. But that doesn't seem to be the church today. And in general, it seems like Christianity is sort of an Amway inspired merchandising club.
That's a mild way of putting it.
And
you know, I talked to a lot of Christian psychologists throughout my journey, and there's one guy named Dr. William Dean, D-I-E-H-M. I don't know if he's still alive or not, but he was just a beautiful man. He was confined to a wheelchair, and he was a quote-unquote Christian psychologist, and he dealt with a lot of pastors and people that were in the ministries and all that. And he was saying that there's a high level of testosterone, if I can say that phrase, mm-hmm. with people who are evangelists especially, because they have this dynamic presence in delivering the gospel of God, and they're almost revered like rock stars.
Yeah.
He says, and the problem is that that's not really what God had in mind with when they were appointing elders, especially back in the beginning of the church period. They were the wiser men, the more quiet men, the one that had a good, strong families, their kids were well-behaved. They were the steady rocks of their community. And these were the ones that were appointed as the teachers and the ones that helped build the disciples. But when you look at these people in church, and I would say with the advent of the electronic media and exploded with the internet, you've got so many people out here who all they have to do is get themselves a .com, and man, all of a sudden they're preachers and they're doing their thing, and they got their pictures all over the place, and the celebrity aspect has become more profound that they forget what their true role was. And that was to be a servant. If you're a servant, you're not driving around in a Bentley. You're not living in a mansion. You don't have a $500,000 salary. And I just think, to me, and this isn't speaking out of jealousy or whatever, but to me, that to me is not a servant. That to me is not a leader. That to me is not a man of God. God does not revere his servants by the size of their congregation. And the thing of it is that these people who are in there, the first thing they say to you, how many people came to the Lord today? you know?
Yeah.
And they're counting, they're down there, you know, marking their little cash registers and their little computer that said, well, you know, we spoke to so many people, we did this, and what was the take today? I got into that part of the ministry from, I think it was 1979 to like about 1985, 86. And actually, that was the worst time of my life. Everywhere I would go, and I'm not going to mention some of the preachers that are well known, yeah. The first conversation out of their mouth, like, you know, how much income are you bringing in? And that, it all had to do with money. It all had to do with status. It all had to do with the things that men see, that mankind sees, that indicates success. You know, you were known how great your ministry was by the size of it. You know, I look at people like, and I don't mind saying this, John Hagee, you know, 20,000, you know, member church. And what's this other guy, Joel Osteen, you know, $35,000 church and all that. And they're preaching prosperity, or they're preaching Zionism and things that are not consistent with the Word of God. So, you know, these guys are becoming successful as the world, quote unquote, knows success. But are they really doing God's work? And I say no.
So do you think in part of that is because the churches are run like a business? You have a church board that you're accountable to and all of that? Or do you just think it's people corrupted by money?
Well, it could be both. Because first of all, there has to be a certain degree of order mm-hmm. within a group. But I would imagine the way I've read the Bible and I look at the different churches in Colossus and Galatia and Thessalonica and all that, if they got to the point that they were so big that they could not be managed, then they're really not doing God's work. You know, church, you know, it means called out ones, mm-hmm. okay? It has nothing to do with the size of the church. Like, what was that guy that had Catholic Crystal Cathedral and the yeah. biggest edifice and the biggest building and the best-looking paintings inside? That was not church. Church was a gathering of people in a certain area, in a certain community, where they were sitting there helping one another. They were helping feed one another. They were helping heal one another. They were praying for each other. It was more of a barter system. If one had a goat with milk and he would sit there and share with the person that maybe grew potatoes or whatever it was a family combined together, loving and supporting one another. But it's gotten away from that. It's become, I don't know if you'd call it the American dream example, but it just looks to me like we have really gotten completely out of the true intent that God had for his called out ones. Right. And I've written several articles about this, like what is revival? People say, oh man, the Holy Spirit came out the other day, we had revival, and 100 people, you know, committed to Christ. And they say, you know, that's not revival. Revival happens with each person individually. If a person with inside of themselves recognizes that they've been wrong and they confess their sins to one another, and if they repent from their sins and they're going into a new direction, that's revival. Revival starts with you individually, that one person. And then when you come in contact with another person, that person's going to see that difference in you. The way you behave, the way you conduct yourself, the way you stand up for yourself, as opposed to being more humble. Now, I'm not talking about being more pious and bowing and all that kind of phony baloney stuff, but I'm talking about they'll see a difference. They'll see that you're not concerned so much about yourself and what kind of accolades you are receiving, but what you're doing to help the person that lives next door, you know. Mm-hmm. You ask people right now to walk down the street where they live, to walk 5 houses down to their left and knock on the door, and I bet you they can't tell you who that person's name is.
Right.
You know? And that's a shame. That person in that 5th house down the street could have kids that are on drugs, the wife and the husband are having problems or whatever it is, but, you know, they don't. We come, we get into our cars, drive to work, do our thing, come back, get back, suck up the beer, watch TV, and boom, that's it. And they said, do you believe in Jesus? Of course I do. I'm a Christian. He said, okay, bye. That's it. Mm-hmm. So, you know, we are not doing real true church as God said. There's that, what is it, James 1:26 says that the true religion as God sees it, as a person who keeps his mouth shut, keeps it to himself, and goes about feeding the poor, the widows, and the orphans.
Yeah.
You know, it's not about what a fancy suit or what a fancy car you drive or whatever. So, I think that's what happened. The culture of the church, I don't think, really got a good head start.
You know, coincidentally, I was listening to an old talk show. Okay, I have to admit this. It was an old Art Bell, but surprisingly, he wasn't talking about aliens. But it was interesting that I would have you on tonight based on what he was talking about. He was referring to a survey, and this was many years ago, and he was talking about the people are happiest in countries that, by American standards, we wouldn't think they would be happy because they were some of the poorer countries.
Right.
And here in America, you know, you have people who are going to shrinks paying all kinds of money, and
right.
The church seems to be confused about where it stands on certain sins and all of that. Do you almost see that God would have to let things happen in this country, such as persecution, for people to get their eyes back on him?
Well, it's a shame that should happen, but I recall as a kid, and we grew up, you know, on the very poor side of society.
Mm-hmm.
My mother and my father, they had 8 kids. We grew up in out there in Indio, California, which is basically an agricultural community. And most of the people that worked out there work in the fields or in the packing houses. There was very few rich people. You were doing pretty much labor kind of work. But I remember that my father would go to work and he'd come home and we'd have dinner and all that. And unfortunately, my mom and my dad separated for some adultery situation that he committed when I guess I was about 8 or 9 years old. So my mother had to raise us 8 kids by ourselves. So we were cast out into the workforce at a very early age. And so we appreciated a little bowl of beans, a tortilla here and there, and that was it. But, you know, we were happy, we were content because we were close. We were helping each other, you know,
mm-hmm.
and we had a strong affinity for our next-door neighbors and stuff. And everybody would share. The person across the street would come over and tell my mom, look, Sally, I cooked a pot roast here, and it's more than I can share. And I brought some over here for your kids or whatever. That, to me, I did have a good concept of church. But then when we started growing a little bit older I was making tons of money in the radio and political arena and all that, had the nice house and so forth. You know, you were kind of on the miserable side of life because you were worried about, you know, things about your psychiatrist or paying this or the
yeah.
country club dues and maintaining the fancy cars and all that other kind of stuff. But I would say that unfortunately, that this really saddens me, is that the true concept of church are getting back to what we thought was a happy time as far as church was concerned, that those days are pretty much gone.
Yeah.
You see this almost every day. I see articles left and right. The kids are leaving the church. The kids are being seduced by media. They're being seduced by the technology that we have, the iPhones and all this other kind of stuff. And it's a pretty blatant thing. And the thing of it is, a lot of people don't understand what's really going on. But this was a designed plan by the enemies of Christ. And they've been building up to this point for the last 300 or 400 years. And I'm talking about Zionist, or I call them the Pharisees, the Mammonites, those people who have sworn to destroy Christianity, and they've been doing it with the tools that they own and control. And we're talking about media, we're talking about radio, television. Unfortunately, you're not on a big network station here or whatever,
right.
But I'll tell you what, if you were, we wouldn't be having this conversation, my friend,
right.
Or at least not very, very long.
No, that's true.
The one good thing about the internet, maybe blog talk radio, is that you have an opportunity for individuals to be able to start up stuff like you're doing and ask relevant questions and point to inwardly to the problems that we have within ourselves that we can solve. And there's a scripture that said that we need to be confessing our sins to one another and sharing in those burdens. When was the last time you heard a sermon like that at the local church?
Yeah, right. You know, one of the things I know that's on your heart are the books you've written. And I want to talk about modern day Bible prophecy. And it's become acceptable to study Bible prophecy with current events, and not just with large current events, but everybody's looking at the blood moons, the popes, and everything you can think of, somebody's socks color and all kinds of stuff. Talk about how this practice is wrong.
Well, first of all, let me state outright, and people can... I have articles on my blog that I've written about this thing, okay? There's one article there. I guess I can send you the link, and all right, people just go over there and look for, Joe Ortiz Associates or the End Times Passover. Just type that in there. The browser, the End Times Passover, and you'll come up with my blogs. You'll come up with my websites. And in there, in the blog, look for an article about prophecy. First of all, the biggest mistake that all these people who have websites, you know, they call the prophecy warning or the prophecy update, the rapture, whatever, you know. First of all, they don't realize this, and people don't realize this, that they are going against God with that type of activity. And I'll tell you why. Jesus Christ told us, it is not for you to be concerned with times and epochs. Only the Father knows. Now, how much more clear can you be about that? Yeah. Only the Father knows when I will be returning to establish the kingdom of God here on earth. He tells us that. It's Acts, in the book of Acts, and I can't think of it just right off of hand. I'm 73 years old, the memory's going, okay? But here's what he's saying. First of all, people don't know the difference between prophecy as in predicting the future or prophecy as in proclaiming the will of God. Okay? Mm-hmm. Proclaiming the will of God is true prophecy. All prophecy stopped when Jesus Christ arrived on earth. Okay? And it says the scripture, and it's in this particular article that I have here. All prophecy stopped. God is not speaking to individuals today with anything new. Anything that God has to say to us has already been written. It's all in the New Testament. There's nothing else that we need to know. And if you look up in the New Testament, you'll not find one single line or one single admonition or one single order. Like, you go out there and read the CNN report and see what's happening in Syria or see what's happening in Iran and then come back here and connect it with Scripture. It's not there.
Right.
Okay? Prophecy means to extol the will of God. But for the last couple of hundred years, people say, I have been a student of prophecy. Okay, if that's the case, then when he says the baptism of the Holy Spirit, these are the gifts that were given, were prophecy, etc., etc., that prophecy was not the ability to predict the future. Mm-hmm. Okay, and it says when the day of Pentecost came, it said your sons will have visions and dreams and all that. Well, that all happened on the day of Pentecost. But since then, there is nothing that says go out there and practice prophesying and practice having dreams and visions. But I can show you 1,500 sites right now. Just go over there and type in your browser, visions and dreams, and you'll get 100,000 different websites that they have people who sit there and they say, oh, here's a dream that I had yesterday. God said this would happen and that this would happen and yada, yada, yada. And these people are getting all these kinds of attention.
Yeah.
Because that's really what it's all about. It's just trying to get attention and thinking that you are somebody special over and above anybody else.
Right.
There's nothing in there whatsoever that anybody can point to in the Bible that turns around and confirms that God is giving special visions or special dreams about upcoming events. There's nothing in there. whatsoever, and I challenge anybody, or anybody wants to challenge me, I'll pay you $1 million if you can show me that scripture.
Yeah.
Okay? It's not there.
Right.
But yet these guys get out there and they say, these great, you know, charismatic preachers and all that, and they said, oh, God revealed to me, and hallelujah, and blah, 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 and the whole bit, and people are falling all over themselves, and they're doing all this hokey-pokey stuff. All that stuff is not of God, my friend.
Right.
And it's not of God. Now, when they started talking about the rapture, I mean, I was happy when I first came to the Lord in 1975. Somebody said, oh, man, you know, we're going to go on the rapture. I said, well, what is that? He said, well, that means that, you know, Jesus is going to come down here in the night like a thief, and he's going to catch us all up, and he's going to take us to heaven, and then all hell will break loose. And all the bad people who will be left behind are going to suffer God's wrath. And I said, whoa, I don't want to be there, you know?
Yeah.
And sure enough, I ate that up for the first 10 years that I was a Christian. I was saved through the Assemblies of God Church, and I believed every bit that they were telling me. I mean, I was just happy to have been saved, so I wasn't going to be questioning any doctrine at that time. But after I started studying and I started reading books, and you know, the journalist in me wants answers. And so I started reading and asking pastors and talking about people. And excuse me, and all of a sudden I found out that a lot of the stuff just didn't jive. You know, first of all, they said the standard phrase that we get out of Luke 17, 34, 37 is two will be standing out into the fields, one will be taken and one will be left. You ask almost 95% of the Christians, who's taken and who's left? And they say, well, the Christian is taken to heaven and the bad people are left. I believe that. So what do? I get the word left just to find out, what does that word really mean? And you look up in the Greek dictionary, and the word left is defined by the Greek word aphemi, which is A-P-H-I-E-M-I, aphemi. And you look underneath for the meaning of that, and you know what it says? It says to forgive. And I said to myself, well, wait a minute. If the good people are taken and the bad people are left behind, but the word left really means forgive, something's wrong here. So now, that's not my opinion. This is not my doctrine. This is not my conjecture. It's what the actual word states.
Mm-hmm.
So I look and say, where else is the Femi used? Okay, so I look up there and I found the Lord's Prayer, where it says, Father, forgive us our sins as we forgive those who have sinned against us. The word forgive in that Lord's Prayer is the word aphemi. Hmm. So can there be any doubt whatsoever that those that are left are forgiven, and, you know, God forgive our sins as we forgive our debtors, that those two words that are identical, not conjecture,
right,
not mistranslated or misinterpreted, but translated properly, they mean the same thing. Well, when I discovered that, I said, wow. So I started researching and using Greek dictionaries and commentaries that other people had made together. And it took me 20 years to write my two books. I started in 1984, and I didn't get them published until 2006. And the reason for that is, after I wrote it, I for the most part finished by 1986, I had, in 2 years, I had pretty much written the two books.
Mm-hmm.
But I kept going over and over and over with a fine-tooth comb, with a magnifying glass. I said, did I get this right? Do I have the correct scripture to verify what I am saying here? Over and over and over and over. And then what I did is, in 2006, I went in, and this is when the internet was going pretty strong. I had a little website and I put it out there and I asked people, you know what? Please download a copy of this and give me your thoughts. And for about 3 years, this was about 203, 204, and for about 3 years, people were taking it and reading it and reading it, and all of a sudden, I'm getting testimonies from some people saying, like, wow, you know, I didn't realize that I've been looking at this the wrong way. And so I wasn't patting on myself that I was so brilliant or whatever. The journalist in me says, you know what? What does this word really mean? Mm-hmm. And I have about 300 different examples of different words that have been misinterpreted to mean a contradistinction to what people believe today.
Yeah.
So this is how I came out with the End Times Passover. It was all one book. I finally went to Author House, and they said they wanted to publish it. But it would have been something like about 890 pages and all that. I said, can we break this down into two books? So the first 15 chapters are a rebuttal to all the claims that anybody that believes in a pre-tribulation rapture that debunks every claim that they make. Anything that anybody has made in support of the pre-tribulation rapture, I debunk it with scripture. The other 12 chapters deal with, well, since now we've proven that the church is going to be here when Christ returns, what does that really mean? Well, it means that we're going to be going through a lot of tribulation.
Mm-hmm.
So the sequel to the End Times Passover is Why Christians Will Suffer Great Tribulation. And you know what? People said, "Ah, no, that'll never happen. God will not allow us to go through this." Well, what has been happening the last 3 or 4 years, Bruce?
Yeah.
The church has been decimated. The church has been attacked. You know, we're here, the homosexual agenda is now dictating what you can do, what you can't do. For example, if a couple, a man and his boyfriend comes in, they want to order a cake from a Christian baker, and if you turn them down, you can be sued and sent to prison.
Mm-hmm.
So if that isn't persecution, my friend, I don't know what is. And this is happening in so many other different forms all over the place. The church is being conquered.
If the churches are under attack, or we being the church are under attack, and a lot of people are focusing on Bible prophecy, current events, and there's a lot of date setting in books today, and there's a lot of fear-based teaching, what should you and I and our listeners be focused on?
Well, obviously, you know, and you're one in a million here. You have the unfortunate thing is that we have a lot of well-intended Christians, people who profess to be men of God, who are out there and have joined the agenda that has been imposed upon us. Joshua, in the book of Joshua, you can look in book, I think it's chapter 23, 24, 25, it says there specifically, Joshua was telling all the Israelites, he says, God fulfilled all the promises that he made to Israel about the land, about everything. He proved it and he did it. So people say, well, he's still got to do it again. No, he doesn't. He said, if you do not obey my laws, I will cast you away. Well, they have a bridge, the covenant that God made with the nation of Israel at the very, very beginning. And people bring up the thing with Genesis, I think it's 12:3, that says, I will bless those who bless you, you know, and I will curse those that curse you. And they say, well, that was given to the Jews. No, it wasn't. That was given to Abraham. Abraham, who is the father of faith. And those who believe in Christ are the children of faith. So he's saying that those of you Christians who people curse you, I will sit there and take care of them. He's talking to believers, not to Jews. But unfortunately, there's so many people that cloud the issue, and they don't know how to make a distinction between, you know, who is a true chosen person of God. Those people who, by faith, they say Abraham is the father of faith. So the descendants, those descendants who believe in Christ, are the chosen people of God. Not the Jews, not the Israelites, not the state of Israel, not Netanyahu, not John Hagee, not any of these people. So, but, you know, call me a voice in the wilderness, but there are a few people out there who are coming out. There's great people there, like Stephen Sizer, for example, a beautiful man out of England. And he was speaking very, very diligently about this. But they've put pressure on him, and they've gotten him to, they've tried to silence him. They put pressure on the forefathers of his church and all that, and they force him off Facebook. And there's other people out there who are speaking out, and guess what? This group of people, these conniving Pharisees, as I call them, they're out there in the internet trying to sit there and confuse the issue, and they're trying to prevent the truth from getting out there. But there's a lot of people out there who are emerging. there's a lot of people out there that I have, you know, tons of friends on Facebook that are followers, and they listen to a lot of the stuff that I have to say, and I send them articles. I said, listen, here it is, Bible-based, backed by Scripture. Now, am I lying or what? Because I've taken the time, okay?
Yeah.
But the thing of it is, all prophecy that people read from the Old Testament was fulfilled in the person of Jesus Christ. Anything that we need to know now about the future is written in Christ. And whatever is written in the New Testament that speaks about the future, he's talking about, you know what, be diligent, stand firm. He says, your redemption draweth nigh. We're getting closer and closer. Do not deviate. It does not say to go over there and subscribe to websites or books about the days of Noah and about Nephilim and about all these UFOs and about all this other stuff that Christians who have opened up websites, they promote this stuff there, but they never deal whatsoever about the soul, the person, and the relationship that they should be having with Christ. They're more concerned about the Vatican. They're more concerned about, you know, flying saucers and demons and monsters and all this other kind of stuff. That's not what Christ wants us to do. Oh, by the way, there's a one section here. I can't think of the name of it, but where I post all my articles and everything else, I'm now being followed on Twitter by Skywalk or Skywatch.
Oh.
That happened today. Wow. By Skywatch, and what's his name, Mr. Sternman or whatever?
Yeah, Stearman.
Yeah, who has that TV program. All of a sudden, I looked up at my email, and he says, hey, we're following you. So apparently, I have not had any problem saying that these people are preaching, you know, a bunch of hocus pocus instead of practicing, you know, the word of God and edifying the church and helping our fellow men and stuff like that, instead of paying attention to all this stuff about UFOs and what they call prophecy, you know. Yeah. Their prophecy, they're saying, well, you know, Iran's going to be bombed, so you got to order this life-saving equipment from us and everything else and read these 10 books. We'll send you 10 free books if you buy this new book here or whatever. And all they're doing is promoting the sale of books, life-saving equipment. Now, let me tell you something. If I believe in the rapture, if I believe that I am going to be caught up into the air and spared any kind of tribulation, what do I need with life-saving equipment?
Yeah.
Now, these people believe that, okay?
Right.
They believe in all these Nephilim, and they believe in all these ghosts, and they believe in all these giants, and they believe in all this other hocus-pocus stuff and everything else. They're trying to scare you, like, you better have your refrigerator full of our new compact freeze-dried food that you can turn on and save yourself and all that. And then I said, wait a minute, I thought you said we were going to be caught up in the rapture. Oh, well, of course, yeah, but, you know, you need to have this just in case.
Yeah.
So what are we talking about? I'm not afraid or ashamed to say, you know what? That's deception. That is the basic outright lying to the people that you should be edifying them and preaching and praying that they get closer to Christ, to study his word, to study his precepts, to follow him, to pick up your cross and take care of the underprivileged people, instead of going out there and spending $30 or $40 on these books here that have no edification purposes whatsoever, any more than the Bible does in telling you the truth of what is God's will. It's very frustrating for me when I see that kind of stuff. So I try to answer and inform these people. I try to dissect the messages that they put out there, and I say, you know what? If this were true, you know, why don't they do this? How come they don't, or did they forget Acts 3:71 or whatever the case is? I try to bring them up to date, to parse between the advertisements. I was in the advertisement community for many years when I was in radio and television. I know the marketplace. I know the tricks and the deceptive ploys that they use to try to get people to buy.
Yeah.
You know, I used to tell people, you know what? I really hate Madison Avenue. And they said, are you kidding, Joe? They're the ones that support you. I said, yeah, I know, but they're pushing stuff out that the people don't need.
Yeah.
You know? People are hungry, they're hurting, and then you make them feel guilty if they don't go out there and buy their daughter the latest new Mustang, 2016 Mustang. You know, so the father bends over, the mom bends over to appease their little daughter, so she can go out there, and she ends up drinking, doing drugs, and messing around, getting pregnant or whatever. You know, Yeah. People have to learn how to discern as to what's reliable, what's real, and what's false. And that's the part that's just very frustrating. And as I said, you do great work on this. I know some other people out there do some great work. Some other people that used to do great works, but they've also turned and they've joined the opposition. And this is sad.
Yeah.
Christians are falling right before our very eyes and they're buying the Kool-Aid.
Right. You know, and I know that there's a survey of Christian fringe Bible prophecy teachers that 100% of their most recent books are the most important book they've ever written. by coincidence. You know...
Name one, huh?
Yeah. And an hour goes by very quick, but before we go... this is an interesting fact about Joe Ortiz. You are the president of the official Tom Flores fan club. I was a big fan of his when he was the head coach of the Oakland Raiders.
A lot of people might not know in Tampa, Florida, who Tom Flores is. Tom Flores won Super Bowl 1981 and in 1985. Uh-huh. And he was the coach of the Oakland Raiders, and the second Super Bowl he won was the coach of the Los Angeles Raiders when they moved to Los Angeles. He was also the first Mexican-American to ever play professional football. He was the first quarterback for the Oakland Raiders from 1960 up until 1968. This guy has accomplished, but he's got four Super Bowl rings, one as a player, one as an assistant coach, and two as the head coach. And this guy has people who only got one or two rings who have been inducted into the Hall of Fame, and they don't even mention Tom's name. So you know, I've known him for the longest time. When I was working in Los Angeles, I was a publicist for the Los Angeles Raiders Boy Scout Celebrity Golf Tournament, and Tom was the chairman of that, and so I got to meet him 25 years ago. Beautiful, beautiful man. A great, great story. All you have to do is put in your browser Tom Flores Legacy, and the website will come up. You can even see a video of me in there talking with my old fat face talking about promoting Tom. But he's on there, and he's just a beautiful man. And other than doing this work here and sharing the word with my brethren, I have a great time promoting Tom to get into the Hall of Fame, and I hope it happens before I leave this earth.
One of my favorite seasons was when he was head coach and Jim Plunkett was the quarterback.
And that was it. In 1981, yeah. See, Jim Plunkett was all washed up. He was drafted by the Boston Patriots about 12 years before that, and he never really made it with the Boston. He went to San Francisco for
second
a couple
string,
years.
Right?
Yeah, and then he ended up with the Oakland Raiders, and it was Tom's inspiration, Tom's motivation that they got him, and they came in, won the wild card, the first wild card team to ever make it to the playoffs, and they went all the way and won the Super Bowl against the Philadelphia Eagles.
Yeah.
And Jim Plunkett was voted the most valuable player that year. You know, Mexican-Americans are great citizens just like anybody else, but when you have guys like this that other young Latino kids can look up to as their idols and all that, they're motivated because these guys are great role models, you know. Yeah. God-fearing, good American, hard-working people. And for some reason or another, we're dumbfounded. We just cannot understand. Matter of fact, there's a new link that came out, which I'll send you, that shows a lot of people are writing in letters and everything else to the NFL Hall of Fame voters. Like, hey, man, what's going on here? But anyway, that's a joy that I have because this guy is just a beautiful, beautiful, hard-working man. And I almost got him convinced that he's got to start preaching for Jesus, too.
Excellent.
Yeah.
You know, not to get off track, but Plunkett's parents were both blind, weren't they?
Yes, they were. They were both blind. And you can just imagine, you know, growing up under that environment.
What a great story. So Joe Ortiz, we've been speaking with Joe Ortiz. And Joe, thank you so much for joining us again this week. And we'll love to have you back the next time you're here.
I appreciate it. It's always a lot of fun. God bless you, my friend. You're doing a great job.
Thank you so much for joining us here at the Bruce Collins Show, where you can find us every Friday night at midnight here at WWPR 1490 AM. Remember, God loves you. We do too. Don't give up.